Hi everyone, the Lone Wolf here, and welcome to an EVE Online dev blog. So as most of you should probably know, CCP is looking to discontinue the in-game browser, which means that I have to find a new way of covering dev blogs when they come out. And with a monthly economic report just coming out, it's a good opportunity to give this a first try. So I've wanted to cover more of these, but I just never really found the time or the right opportunity to do so. But every month, CCP Quant comes out with some interesting numbers on the EVE economy in general, and on import and export mostly. And this can be very interesting, especially to EVE Talk viewers, people that that want to trade, that want to produce stuff, that actually want to try to earn some ISK by playing the market game in EVE Online. So let's just get started. A lot of this could actually be pretty interesting. And the first chart here is production versus destruction. So you've got a green line, which is the end products produced in value. You can see a pretty big jump up here, which is of course the Citadel expansion in May. All the production of Citadel's related modules and rigs caused a really big jump in the amount produced in EVE Online, but now after about 2.5 months we actually pretty much recovered that and we're back in line with normal production for the game. The blue line is stuff that gets destroyed, so blowing up of ships, bosses, all of that good stuff, actually holding on quite nicely in the month of July right here, staying just below the 1 trillion mark. I think that this is actually quite okay for summer activity. If you look at it, it's not very visible, but what you can see if we start here, you can see the dip August, September, here again the dip August, September, July, August, September, and then here we have a third summer right here, right August, July is actually the bottom here, but still September as well. So this is of course typical for MMOs, not just for EVE Online, but during the summer activity does tend to decrease a little bit. And of course, here we come off a high in April of World War B. So as a result, I think that where we're standing now, it's better than the last few years. So we're still holding on quite nicely during July, but August and September do tend to be the bottoms for destruction. That's something to keep in mind. That probably means that not that much needs to be replaced, or not as much as usual. And that's when the third line comes in right here. We've got amount mined, of course, which does indicate a bit of a decrease in activity in EVE Online, as throughout July we've dropped a decent amount in mining. But put all of these together and I think you get a pretty interesting picture. What is very noticeable is that the amount produced has diminished by quite a bit more than the amount mined. Add to that the amount of destruction is still holding pretty high, but I'm personally expecting this to drop off a little bit in August and September. You actually get a situation where minerals are going down in value quite a bit, and we've noticed that in EVE Talk. And personally, I'm seeing this as a good opportunity to not just mine and sell or to just try to get by with the amount of minerals, but to actually start building some stocks of minerals, because I think that when activity picks up again, the value of these will actually increase quite a bit. So I'm actually seeing an opportunity for stocking up on minerals and waiting for the right trade opportunity. And I think I've spotted that in EVE Talk, or at least that's my personal expectation. And I think that these charts actually show that it could actually be the case. So I'm going to risk that. I'm going to start building up minerals rather than selling them. And of course, as always, I'll keep you posted on whether or not I was right. The next chart here is the key economic figures by region. This can be pretty interesting, but it's not unexpected either. You of course have the Forge and Lone Trek with pretty high destruction, and then Black Rise here, pretty high destruction and very low activity. So if you want some pure PvP, it looks like you want to go to Black Rise. But here you can see Citadel, Lone Trek and the Forge with quite a bit of destruction, but also a lot of mining happening there, also a lot of production happening there. Net imports in the Forge, which is Jita itself, and then exports in Lone Trek and the Citadel. This is why I've got Dotlan open right here. You can see that from Jita, you can go to Sobaseki in Lone Trek, and you can go to, goddammit, well, I'm not even going to pronounce that one, but to a system in the Citadel as well, all in Isaac. So these charts, this extremely high activity in these three regions is actually all tied to the biggest trade hub in the game, to Jita itself. So the trade value right here in Jita, of course, springs out quite a bit as well. You've got the Forge with Jita, with by far the biggest trade hub. Then you've got Domain with Amar system, and then Sync Liaison with which is Dodixie, the Galente trade hub, but quite a bit smaller than Jita, as you can see. But all the other really big bars here, production happening in Lone Trek and in the Citadel, for instance, is again related to Jita. So I think that this is basically a recurring picture. This is something that we'll usually see. What could switch out is, of course, the amount destroyed in like maybe a Nullsec heavy region when a big war breaks out or something like that. But all of these production, net exports and net imports numbers around Jita are basically set in stone as long as Jita stands. Next up are two charts. I'm actually not going to cover the first one, but I will jump straight to the second one because it's all about exports and imports. The previous chart is basically showing both the exports and the imports on the same chart. But here, once again, you get a very similar picture where Lone Trek and the Citadel have really big export values because a lot of stuff moves through these regions into Jita itself, and a lot of stuff is being mined and produced in those regions that then end up in Jita as well. And then Domain here as the third big one is due to the Amar trade hub. And all the way at the bottom here, you've got Iridia for really big imports and the Forge as well for really big imports. But all of this is basically economic activity around Jita, which only makes a lot of sense because, of course, Jita is the biggest trade hub in the game. A lot of stuff is being sold and traded there every single day. But people want to produce close by so that they can reduce the opportunity cost, the time needed to actually haul their stuff to Jita. They want to keep that as low as possible. And so, of course, Lone Trek and the Citadel are two other regions where a lot of people do a lot of stuff, especially for Jita, which is why you're seeing such high numbers for those. Next up, this is one that I really find very interesting. You've got ISK sinks and faucets. So you can see that the bounty prizes are by far the biggest ISK faucets. Then you've got commodities, so NPC markets. You've got some ISK sinks. So I think those will be loyalty point stores when you sometimes have to put in ISK. Maybe stuff like skill books as well, blueprint originals. The blue line is the faucet from NPC markets. This is probably mostly going to be blue loot from Wormhole Space. So the sleepers drop blue loot that is specifically bought by the NPCs in the game itself, in certain stations. And so this is obviously a pretty big net faucet as well. An activity that needs to basically compete with bounty prizes when it comes to efficiency. And so as a result, you know, it's normal that it will always remain a net faucet here unless CCP changes something drastically. Incursion payouts, not that bad. Of course, not as big as bounty prizes, but definitely a major faucet as well. And then here we've got insurance. So the red bar is the sink, which means that people are paying to take insurance. And then the blue bar is the faucet, which means that more has been paid out to players as a result of their loss than they have actually invested in insurance. That basically, I think, means that a lot of ships still explode without insurance. And as a result, they haven't paid any ISK, but they got some ISK back. Agent mission rewards, not that big. And then time bonus rewards, pretty big as well. So most missions are actually completed within the set time frame. Maybe CCP could actually take a look at that, considering that close to 100% are being done on time. They could either maybe get rid of the time bonus, or what they could try as well is maybe make that a bit more challenging or something like that. This part right here is probably the most interesting one. You can see that 73.6 trillion ISK has been added in the game through all the different faucets, and 46.9 has been destroyed through the sinks. So this is a net gain, but the active ISK delta is also down 21.6 trillion ISK. So this is normally from accounts that have deactivated. And so this once again shows, I think, the decrease in activity through the summer in EVE Online, which is just a recurring thing. In my opinion, not something to worry too much about. People want to go outside at the moment. I guess there a lot of people are playing Pokemon Go rather than EVE Online. And as a result, 21.6 trillion ISK in wallets, whether they be personal wallets or corporation wallets, has basically gone inactive. It's still a net gain though, 73, and this is like 68. A bit less than that trillion ISK. So a net gain in faucet, net inflation of the amount of ISK in the game, despite this decrease in activity, does mean that people have been pretty busy ratting up a storm of ISK in the game. Probably after World War B, a lot of people felt like bringing their wallets back into good shape there. So net increase in the amount of ISK in the game over the last month. It was actually different right after the launch of the Citadel expansion, which is something that was actually not very common in EVE Online. You usually have a picture like this where more ISK comes in than is being destroyed. With the blueprint purchase of the Citadel expansion, we actually had some actual deflation in the amount of ISK in the game. So pretty interesting to see that here once again, we're back to normal. We're back to having some inflation in the game. That the Citadel expansion basically seems to have been absorbed by the ETH economy. Next chart is going to be the money supply. So here, this is a total view over several years from 2013 up to 2016. You can see the increase in ISK right here, May, or is it April? Yeah, April to May. You do see this decrease in the amount of ISK, which is the deflation I was just talking about, due to the Citadel expansion, where people had to spend, like I spent 6 billion ISK to buy an Astralis Blueprint original, for instance. And so here, this is something that only happened once before in the last 4 years here, where I actually had some deflation. Don't ask me what this is exactly. Don't really know. This is really a big sudden markup, maybe a huge ban wave or something like that. And then of course it's also broken down in personal wallets from characters and corporation wallets right here, giving you the total of 953 trillion ISK that's available in the game right now in active wallets. One thing that I want to note here, it's something that we saw at FanFest, and it's something that I was not aware of until it was revealed to us, and so I do think it's pretty important. It is that at current valuation, you probably have close to 3 times that in stuff in EVE Online. So even if you were to somehow be able to grab all the ISK in the game, you would not be able to buy all the stuff that's available in the game. And as a result, ISK inflation, while it is constant and to be expected in an online economy, valuation is completely different. And so the impact on goods is, it's not that ISK inflation is killing the game just because there is ISK inflation. There is the inflation of goods as well. And at the moment, something to keep in mind is that if you would value everything on average in the game as they're being traded, you actually end up with a much larger amount of value in stuff than you actually have ISK available in the game, which I thought was pretty damn interesting. Something to always keep at the back of your mind when you're thinking, well, inflation is going to end up increasing the value of everything. It's really not that simple. Another chart of the velocity of ISK here. Once again, of course, this huge spike of ISK velocity, which actually brought velocity above 1.1. So total trade value for the past 30 days, total available divided by total available ISK, i.e. over the last 30 days, how many times has one each ISK exchange hands on the market on average. And so this is not Citadel expansion. You may think that maybe it's the Citadel expansion, but it's actually the skill extractors and the skill traders that actually caused the ISK velocity to rise above one, which means that every ISK will have been traded on average one time in the month of February. There we go, when the skill extractors and skill injectors were launched. This is now also slowly recovering because here, probably supported by the Citadel expansion, we stayed pretty damn high, but an average seems to be around 0.5. So here we're finally getting back to average, still a little bit above average for the month of July. That does surprise me just a little bit. But yeah, considering we had to recover from this huge spike, maybe this is normal. We'll have to see September and August where we'll actually bottom out. So here again, summer, bit of a dip. December here, bit of a dip as well. So it's not as clear a picture as what we had in the destruction chart. And then next up, let's see the economic indices. I'll quickly touch on them, but I have to be honest, I don't know exactly what's behind all of these. So you have the CPI, which I think is just general game economy metric, which is actually going down pretty decently here again, dipping throughout the summer. If this is indeed a general metric, then this would support a bit of lower activity throughout the game. This also starts in 2004, so actually have activity throughout the entire game. That's pretty interesting. The mineral price index, I'm a bit surprised that one is actually going up here at the tail end, but this is of course not as detailed, so it is possible that this will actually go back down as mineral prices are going down substantially at the moment. Then I think primary producer index is production of Tech 1 stuff, which is up a little bit, and then secondary producer index, which is down substantially. That is actually quite interesting in my opinion. For people that watch EVE Talk, they know that I always do keep an eye on the Tech 2 market for active trading. After the launch of Citadel, we actually had a decrease in volatility in the Tech 2 market, which I think was due to the taxes that have been increased with the Citadel expansion. What is pretty interesting here is that we can clearly see that the CPI, secondary producer index here, is dropping quite rapidly as well. So as a result, maybe if the average values go down low enough, we'll actually see some buy opportunities or something like that. I'm not exactly sure how to interpret this chart, but I think it could be interesting to see the secondary index drop like this and try to find the right opportunity, the right time to once again take a close look at the Tech 2 market and see if there are no trade opportunities there, because a drop like that should usually mean an opportunity that starts to form if we ever reach a bottom. So yeah, the indices, you know, if you have more background on this, feel free to post that in the comments, because honestly, I don't know exactly what's behind all of this, and that makes interpreting this quite difficult for me. The other charts below here, I'm also not going to cover them. I think you can start to see that they become quite a bit more technical and difficult to interpret. These are basically the decompositions of all the different indices. So if you want to do your homework on that, if you want more than just the general picture, which is what I gave you right here in this video, then of course you should head to the dev blog itself, on the community website, really start digging through all of this information, because it's pretty awesome that CCPQuant puts this out every month for us to enjoy, to pick through, and to see if there is stuff that we can take advantage of. Anyways, that's going to be it for this dev blog, the monthly economic report for July 2016. I hope that some of this information can be useful for you. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you all next time.